Mogie Players in Sixmilebridge, County Clare. It's summer pride.
Where is Sixmilebridge? I suppose the best thing is to look at the sign and see what that says. Well, we're 10 miles from Limerick. We are 8 miles from Shannon Airport. We're 15 miles from Ennis and 15 miles from Killaloe, also in the direction of Fort William Farmhouse. Shannon is the main influence on Sixmilebridge. It has led to a huge increase in population. In the 1986 census, we were the fastest growing village in the country. And the contribution made by the people who came to live in Sixmilebridge has been immense. Our club has developed a lot over the years. We cater for hurling at all grades, right up from under 8s and 10s through to senior. We also look after football and camogie also for all ages. East Clare naturally makes you think of hurling, makes you think of dancing, makes you think of music. And our club also has achieved a lot in terms of score. Sixmilebridge GAA Club was founded in 1904, and since then we have achieved a lot. The club won its first championship in 1977, and since then has added a further 6 championships. We also have got All-Star awards. Various players have achieved those that were won by Noel Casey, Niall McInerney, Jerry McInerney, John and John O'Connell, and Sean Stack, of course.
The man gets it to Sean Stack. The elegant wing back.
In the space of about 13 years, we Sixmilebridge have come from a situation where we gave a walkover in the championship. I remember in my first championship game in 1972, to at this stage now that we have 7 senior championships under our belt, and far too numerous to mention. The number of underage and minor and 21s. And I mean, in the space of 13 years, it has transformed itself to us being 300 yards down the road, they're tugging out under a ditch and lead that we had running water, like, which was a stream nearby. Now to this setup here, that we have a stand and we have a field and dressing rooms and a second pitch 100 yards up the road. I mean, to visualise that 15 years ago, it was only pie in the sky. So I think we've come in an enormous amount of progress has been made in that time.
Okay, lads, we're heading now for the well. And we've all our preparation done, right? We've trained hard. We've spent a lot of time here in the field over the past 2 months. A lot of hard training has been put in. So when we get out there, we're going to settle, right? Relax tonight and be ready for the morning, right? Think back. There was guys in here Saturdays after Saturdays training, right? And all that hard work has gone in over the past 3 or 4 years. And that's why you're going to fail. That's why we went out in Clare, because we put in a lot of hard work over the past 3 years or 4 years. And we're going to do the bridge proud and Clare proud when we get out there, OK? So the best of luck to everyone, you lads, and I know you're going to huddle out of your skins.
On the ball, lads, on the ball! Well done, Fitz, for that's great, Holland. Come on, Damien, start thinking.
Come on, Billy.
Come on, Damien.
Come on, Christian.
You can just take it off.
Move it into the
corner. Come on, turn.
Come on.
Come on,
now. Come on, out, full forward line.
Come on,
get there with him.
Come on, lift your head. Ready?
Well, we feel if young people are active, they won't get involved in the risks which are there nowadays. If they're involved in sport and so forth, drugs and drink and so forth, these temptations won't involve them too much. And if there is an organisation there, young people will become involved if the facilities are made available, and they have been.
Well, to the present Sixmilebridge team, we have lost an awful lot of our players over the last few years, and now we're building up again with a crowd of young fellas. So we're more hopeful than confident this year. They are very enthusiastic, and we're playing our near neighbours in the first round of the championship. And we have had a reasonably good run in the cup, so we're looking forward to, not overconfident, but hopeful.
The one thing we will have to do if we are going to succeed, and our ambition, of course, would be to win an All-Ireland club. We have won a Munster club, but we'd like to win an All-Ireland club, and we're good enough. But I think we'll have to start putting more emphasis on playing some of our good players up front. We're inclined to play our best players in the back and centre field, and I think at the present rules today, your winning of your match has to be your forwards.
I'd like to think we're there or thereabouts again. A lot of good young lads coming through, brought them on in the last few years. A few more lads gone into it this year, so I'd say that I wouldn't rule them out at all.
How many are we going to get off of that minor team that won the championship last year, would you think?
I think we'll get about two or three.
Well,
I do, yeah.
Sixmilebridge was always the be-all and end-all for me, you know, and most of the players I played with. Like the Sunday, the bridge we'd be playing, that was the Sunday we looked forward to most. I mean, playing with the county was fabulous when you're successful, you know what I mean, and when you're going well. And I mean, we had great days playing with Clare, and we had good successes. And then, of course, we had far too numerous days that we just want to forget about too. But allegiance to the club is, I think, that's where your start and finishing point is, and playing with the county is a bonus, you know. The training just differs depending on who your trainer is. And I mean, we trained as hard back in the early 70s as we did in the early 90s. I mean, now they say that that people are putting far too much emphasis on fitness, but I don't think so. You know, I mean, and I think the game has transgressed into a situation where you have to be far fitter now than you had to be 15 or 20 years ago. So training is the same. It just depends who's doing it and who's giving calling the shots. You know.
Thank you.
This is the last resting place of the late Dr. Tommy Daly, recognised throughout hurling world as one of the greatest hurling goalkeepers of all time. I know him well, and as well as being a great goalkeeper, he was one of the friendliest persons you could meet. I played with him, and you couldn't play with a better companion. He was just a lovely, jovial person. Well, I happened to be captain of that Clare team, the last Clare team that won the senior championship, and that was in 1932. We must have had a good team to beat that Cork team that the year before that won the All Ireland after such a heroic struggles in their part. And as you all know now, that's the last time so far that Clare won the Munster Senior Championship.
And that's gone off the post, back down. A great stop once again by Frank Lowen. Out it comes towards Anthony Daly. What a heart-stopping finish we have to this match. Fergal Toohey trying to skip around Fergal Ryan there. Fergie Toohey, Steve, oh, it's all over! And Clare have won. Clare have won this match. It's Clare 2-13, Cork 3-9. Clare in a third successive Munster final.
It is our third Munster final in a row, and the one thing you have to do is get to finals to win them, and we are getting them. Now, we have every team in Ireland beat in the last 3 years, but we haven't any trophy to show for it. So I'm adamant, I think that we're going to have a right cut at this Limerick team, and I think we can win it.
I was told not to say anything about this, but my opinion is that Limerick, the All-Ireland was robbed from them last year. I mean, they dominated the game for 50 minutes or 60 minutes, and it all happened in 2 or 3 minutes again. So I would be very confident if that game was played again that Limerick would have won it by the 5 points that they were up at the time when all hell broke loose for Offaly. But that was a miracle win. And so to me, like, they are probably the best team in Ireland last year. I know Offaly have a lot to say with that, but they know, they'll admit themselves too, they were lucky to get the break from Joe Dooley's goal. But they're all Ireland champions, and they trounced Clare last year in the Munster final. And now we're 12 months down the road, we have the same teams, bar one in the Limerick team, Joe O'Connor is out. We have the same Clare team, bar our centre-back. Sean McMahon is most likely out for the final. And, I mean, who's going to say that the result won't be the same?
Yeah, well, of course, talk is cheap, but it's always cheap to listen to it. You know, an action speaks louder than words. On the day, now, we're very hopeful. The Clare have been knocking it off for quite a while. We've just been talking there now about forwards and backs. One of the greatest forwards we ever had in Sixmilebridge, anyone, I'm sure, in Clare, was Noel Casey. He started his hurling cornerback. He played in goal, he played in every position in the field. And I would love to have a few Noel Caseys, or even two more, down there on the 9th of July.
I don't know, I looked at the bookies office this morning and I thought the betting was a small bit ridiculous. Even though Clare haven't won a Munster championship for 60 odd years, I think Limerick were 7-2-1 and Clare were 11-4. In fairness to Clare, and I think Christy just pointed out there, they have beaten every team, all the strong teams in the country over the last number of years. Okay, they have no trophy to show for it, but I would like to think that they will make that breakthrough this year, even though they're probably man-to-man not as good a team as Limerick, but the last 10 minutes in Cork showed something on this Clare team that I haven't ever seen, and that is never said die attitude, even though twice in the last quarter of an hour against Cork they fell behind. The type of spirit that's there is the type of spirit that's required to win championships, and I think they have it.
This is what Clare have to do. Clare have been as good and better, as they have proved, as any team in Munster. But this nerves, this thing the night before the match. Now I'm hopeful, lads, that that has gone by, and that this year they'll forget about that.
Well, it's an inferiority complex too, you see. I mean, if you haven't something won, it's very difficult when the game goes against you. It's very difficult for 15 lads in unison to pick it up again. But if you have nothing won and you've got 7 or 8 points up, then you see fellas can play out of their skin then, you know what I mean? So I think elements have a huge bearing on underdog teams, definitely, if they have to have a chance.
There's a look element in all these matches when it comes down to the wire. That particular day against Cork, like in most years, if Cork scored the goal against Clare in the dying minutes, we'd be beaten by 4 or 5 points. But suddenly, to the amazement of us all, Clare came back and got the goal to win it. Now that look, if they carry that forward into the Munster final, they're coming up against a very good Limerick team who have beaten them last year and beaten them well. They were beaten the year before by Tipperary and beaten well. It's a psychological thing as well, you see, and if they can get that thing out of their minds and if they get the break and the bit of luck, I'd be very hopeful. I mean, it comes down to this, that after being in it for the third year running, they should be able to at least to win it.
Are we going to win the Munster final? Yeah, I think so. We've trained hard, we've prepared hard, and the spirit is very good at the moment, so yeah, we're looking forward to it.
Clare hasn't a great track record, has it, though?
No. But I think this year we reached the league final. We didn't do very well, but in the past 2 years, Clare haven't had a good experience in Munster finals, but haven't had a chance later on after that to atone for it. But this year we lost the league final, and now we're in the Munster final, so we have a chance to make up for it. So we're looking forward to that.
Sean Stack isn't so sure, by the way.
Sean Stack? Well, I mean, he's a good judge of hurling, but... I mean, no. I think most hurling followers around the country wouldn't give Clare a chance against Limerick, and that's the way we want it. And July 9th might tell a different story.
Do you think Clare are going to win next Sunday?
Yeah, I'd say they would win next Sunday because they're a good team and everything.
And who's the best player?
I'd say Osh. And I'd say the goalie is the best, maybe Fitz, because he's the best goalie in the country.
Now, what about Michael Halloran?
I'd say he's good enough.
Do you go to hurling matches?
Yeah.
Are you going to go to see Clare playing Limerick?
Yeah.
Where is it going to be?
Limerick.
Who's going to win?
I mean, Tullis.
Oh, good man. Who's going to win?
Clare.
How do you know?
Because they're the best.
Easily?
Yeah, they're going to win. Yeah, they're going to make fool of them. I want 5-15 to no score. That's Mike Halloran will clean them all, won't you, Mike?
Is Mike the best hurler on the Clare team?
He's not better than me.
Not better than you? And when are you going to play on the Clare team?
Full forward.
But when?
Oh, 2 weeks' time.
Oh. Well, anyway, you think Clare are going to murder Limerick?
Yeah.
And what did you say the score was going to be again?
5-15 to no score.
30 or 40 years ago, there was more emphasis placed on ground hurling. And some people will tell you, and I have a kind of an idea myself, that if you strike the ball on the ground fast when you get it, that it will travel a lot faster than a ball that's poked from a hurley and going into the sky. The ball that's going into the sky has to drop so many yards away, 40, 50 or 60 yards away. But you have to wait for it to come down. Whereas the ball that's stuck first time on the ground, it travels at a tremendous speed, a certain distance, sometimes long, sometimes short, actually can prove to be faster if you could put the two side by side. Now, I say that we did not undergo very intensive training in my time. In those days, for the local club matches, very little was done. You did it on your own in the evenings and arranged matches sometimes between one club and another. But it was taken in a very kind of a casual kind of way. You had some very dedicated people, some not so dedicated, as you have in all sports. But the training has changed, all right. It is semi-professional now.
Now, that was a very good session, lads, and well done. But what I'd like to talk to you for a moment or two is, we come here 3 days a week for an hour, right? Now, there's no hurler at your age of 12 years or 11 years going to make it on 3 hours a week, right? You see your coaches over there. Now, they're prepared to come here and impart their knowledge to you. Is that clear? So, from now on,
the type of work you have to do is you come here the 3 days a week with your coaches and myself, and we all stick together because we're in here for the long haul. We're looking at this for maybe 10 years of solid work so that you'll be playing hurling for Sixmilebridge and maybe representing Clare in the Munster Championship or possibly in the All-Ireland in 10 years' time. So that's our aim. There's nothing short-term here. We're not trying to win the Under-12 Championship, but we're trying to produce hurlers to represent Clare and represent Sixmilebridge that will win senior championships. John, can you give any advice to these lads?
Lads, I'll only tell you one, tell you that keep working, keep hurling, and if you want to make the Clare team, you'll make it in 10 years' time.
Well, in the past 10 years, we'll say we have won 8 county champions so far, but in the last 2 years, we're actually bringing up starting under 16s and under 14s for the first time onto the senior team. So it's only really this year, again, we're starting to rebuild, so it'll take us about another 2 years to actually get back up in the top again. Mm. But this year, we have a very fair team this year for the county.
Many county players?
4.
Who are they?
There is Siobhan Sullivan, there is Linda Quinn, Patricia O'Grady and Nolan Neal.
You know, I think it's fantastic the way the girls go out and, you know, we give it our all, we try our best and what more can we do? Mm-hmm. It's for our club, so we're proud of our village, so we try our very best for our village.
We get our mothers in to make the tea.
Exactly.
Fair enough. A lot of people say that it's not a ladies' game, by the way, that it's too rough.
No, not now. The standard of camogie has come up a lot and there's a lot more skill involved. Whereas maybe years ago it was recognised as rough, but the younger generation is coming up are being taught skills earlier on. So by the time they actually get to senior, then they are very skillful players. So the game is not that rough. It's quite a nice game to actually play.
Yeah, I agree. It's a lovely game to play. It's what you make of it, really.
Right, the media should take way more coverage in camogie. There is very, very little coverage throughout the whole country. But maybe from now on, they're actually starting to recognise camogie as just as important as actually the men themselves. So maybe take us a long time to get there, but in time I think we'll actually show them that we need actually more. To bring on the youth, we need more media, so they'll actually see it then and they'll say, you know, this is just as interesting as every other sport, so...
The women, in my opinion, now are always very important in a club. A man is only as good as what his other half will be, or his mother, sister, whatever woman he has left at home. And it's very encouraging there when you know you have a backup. Because after all, at the end of the day, you come home to them, and it's there that all starts. It's there you're chatted out. And here in Sixmilebridge, we're very, very fortunate.
I think we couldn't do without him. Is outside of the camogie side of it, which is very, very important and a great outlet for a lot of young girls in the parish, there are a lot of ladies involved in behind the scenes and people, you know, like, who never get the glory, but they're there when a team has to be fed after a match, and they're there when visitors come to look after them, and they're there if there's a concert ticket to be sold, and they are really the lifeblood of the club, no question about it.
Young girls that are there today, they have a lot of spare time, and it's a pursuit that's good for them, and it's good for the club as well, because as Christy said, they become involved in other aspects of the club as well, and they're a great asset to us. So yes, it's very good for the parish, and we're delighted to have them.
We have a very tight-knit community here, and the camogies play a big part in our club. Like most of us, there's a lot of the senior players' wives out there, and girlfriends, and sisters, and brothers, and we're all kind of in it for the one thing, for the promotion of the games, and at the end of the day, if the camogies are playing, we give them a shout on. And if we are playing, they follow us and shout us on. And hopefully we'll keep going. And unity is the best. We find is the best.
What has made the achievements in Sixmilebridge possible is the hard work, the voluntary effort of a lot of people, both people who have been here traditionally and new people who moved into the parish. Voluntary effort, dedication, work over a long period. I suppose that's what makes the difference, and that's what makes the achievement of the people of Sixmilebridge so special. And I suppose if there's anything that other villages or towns or clubs could learn from us, I suppose it would be along those lines. That's what makes Sixmilebridge special, and that's what accounts to our success over the last couple of years.
There's another double bill of Summer Pride next week at the same time here on RTÉ 2. Coming up next tonight, it's CSI Miami, where one film star gets his curtain call.